заслужили!
Hello guys. Recently I did a video where I searched 200 stashes on woods to see how much money you can make per raid, and the results were actually pretty good. I was making 700k rubles per raid guaranteed, and it was one of the easiest and safest ways to make money in Tarkov, in my opinion, of course. So I wanted to search 200 stashes on Shoreline and see if the results are going to be better, worse, or maybe the same as woods. So first thing that I want to talk about is the map. I want to show you what caches specifically I usually went for, which ones I looted, and which ones I didn't really go for that much. If you spawn on the village side, you can loot a lot of stashes in one little area, and then, you know, move through the middle and do the other side. Or you can do the others, the same thing from the other side too. So this map actually didn't have too much backtracking compared to woods. I would say that Shoreline is actually easier and faster to navigate compared to woods. So basically, if I spawned on the village side, I would pretty much do all of these stashes, but in a random sequence. In the swamp area, there's 5 stashes, and there's this one that I always skipped, because this stash is specifically hard to get to because it is in the swamp area, so you walk really slow to get to it. And this is why I just avoided it, because it also is not that good of an idea to be stuck in the swamp, especially if you spawn anywhere close here, and if you go straight down to this stash, you risk of being shot by someone who spawned close to you. So I just avoided this because it was too much of a risk. Same would be said about the stash in the suicide field, so-called suicide field. I would always skip this one because it also is one of those stashes that is way too much in the open. Then I would skip all 3 of these up here because it would take way too much time to go up here, loot them all, and then go all the way back. It didn't seem like a good idea to include these 4 stashes over here, like this one, 1, 2, 3, and 4. So I would skip those 4 because cutting this big area, top area, from your route saves you quite a bit of time, in my opinion. But I don't know, like, I wasn't doing this to have the most time efficient runs, so you could probably make this more efficient. Now if you look to the right side where the road to custom site is, you can see that there's also quite a bit of stashes. They're just a little bit more in between compared to village. They're not so bunched up together, so it takes a little bit more time to run to each one of those. As you can see, in total there's 29 caches that I marked, so those 29 would be the ones that I would always hit. The only ones I would skip would be the suicide field, the one in the swamps, 3 up above top of the map, 1 next to the resort on the rocks. Well, I kind of forgot about this one here. I just missed it somehow. And I would also skip the ones down below at the beach and by the lighthouse, and one of the Scav Island. Because honestly, like, cutting out the top part of the stashes and the bottom, you save a lot of time and you don't really like miss too many stashes, because the biggest part of stashes is, like, you know, as you can see, bunched up together in these 2 big areas. So I would, regardless which side I start on, I would do for one side first, and then I would cross through the bus station, check those 2 stashes around the bus station, and then I would, you know, move on to the other side. I also want to mention that compared to woods, this map is not as big and as empty as woods. So on Shoreline, if you do daytime raids, which is what I did, you will most likely run into PMCs. You will definitely run into scav spawning around. So this map is less safe compared to woods, mostly because you have choke points and you have, like, areas where there's a lot of stashes, and there's also scavs and PMCs hanging around. The area where I met the most amount of people while doing these stash runs was village. the old village and around the bus station. Bus station makes sense because it's a choke point. People have to cross the river to go from one side of the map to the other, and it's fairly easy to meet someone because there's only 5 places to cross the river, and eventually you will run into someone crossing the river at the same time as you. Of course, if you're just aiming for the stashes, if you don't want any unwanted attention, technically you could hide in a bush and wait for someone to pass, because that's what I've done. But what I noticed, or what I got quite a bit, I got into a lot of fights with PMCs, sometimes even in some random areas where I didn't really expect to see anyone. So every time I would run into a PMC and we would have a fight, it would end in 2 ways. First, I kill them, which means if they have any decent loot, I loot them, and I can't really take any more loot from the stashes, and I have to get out, which kind of, you know, disrupts my stash run. Or I die, and you know, it disrupts my stash run. So either way, it's not that easy to focus on just stashes during the daytime raids on Shoreline. But if you do nighttime, technically you probably will have much easier time doing only stashes if you don't want any unwanted attention from PMCs or even scavs, because scavs also have worse vision during the nighttime. So yeah, I would say that if you really want to have safe raids where you don't meet any PMCs or scavs don't aggro on you as much, do nighttime raids, and you should have actually better results, especially since during the daytime raids, when there's more people, a lot more stashes are also looted before you get to them, so you don't even get to loot all of them during the raid. Now let's talk about the good part, about the results, what kind of items we managed to find. So let's begin with the categories. Once again, I didn't really change much from the last video. I kept the same system of categorizing all the items. We got electronic items category, we got treasure items, we got gear. The only stuff you see in the gear category is helmets, armor, headphones, and backpacks. Then we have medical items, we have other items, of course, weapons, and food items. So I put a black line this time. Items under this line are actually not that great of value, but they are still worth taking if you have empty spaces left. The way I do looting is I always think of items when I pick them up. Are they 10k or more per slot value? If they are less than 10k per slot value and I am full, I usually don't pick them up. So I always try to have my items in my backpack 10k per slot value or more. So as you can see, we got a GPU. That was like, I think, first or second raid that I was doing this, and it was actually pretty crazy. Finding a GPU so early was... I actually thought that I'm gonna find much, much better loot, but eventually it evened out. So as you can see, we got a GPU, we got SAS, we got Cyclon, Nixor Lens, GPX, PCB, ES lamp, UV lamp, and rechargeable battery. Everything that is below that, as you can see, the power cord, capacitors, wires, helix, those go around 9k usually, but they sometimes fluctuate. You can sometimes sell them for even 15k. Sometimes they go down to 6 or 7k. So it really depends what time you're doing this. So take this information with a grain of salt. And the drop rate for electronics was almost 30%, which is actually really high. Now, if you look at treasure items, I'd say this time on Shoreline, I was having much better loot when it comes to treasure items compared to woods. The only bad items, you could say, were chainlet and horse statue. Those were the two only items that were actually really bad per slot value, 5 and 4k per slot value. Everything else was 10k or more. And as you can see, we got a roller, golden skull, GP coin, and we got quite a few of those streamer items like Lupo Beans, Fire Clean, 40-second tea. So yeah, we got way more treasure items this time. for treasure items, the drop rate was only 10%, but it is still pretty profitable because those items, most of them were quite valuable. Now, when it comes to medical items, there were only 4 items that actually managed to give you more than 10k per slot value. So that was AFAC, IFAC, Alu Splint, and Morphine. Everything else was less than 10k per slot value. And the drop rate was 11.5%. Once again, medical items, just like on woods, were not really that common to spawn in the stashes. Now, if you look at weapons, the drop rate was 17%. I think that was higher than it was on woods. But as you can see, there were only 3 items that barely managed to reach the 10k per slot value, which means weapons were not the most profitable thing to pick up. Although, usually when you do stash runs, you tend to have maybe one. Some people maybe do it without any weapons. So you can still pick up those items because, you know, you have empty slots. The most valuable weapons were the VOG grenade, FN57 pistol, and a P90. Everything else was not really worth taking up slots in your backpack or your vest unless you had, you know, them free. So this time weapons weren't really that great too. Just like on woods, you won't find too many good items. You won't find too many good weapons. When it comes to gear, we got a lot of items. We got actually 62 gear items, which is 31% drop rate. Once again, just like on woods, chances of finding any piece of armor, helmets, headphones, or bags is very high. It's 1/3, so that's a lot. We got quite a few items that are 10k per slot value or more. The most notable ones would be Airframe Tan Helmet, ULAC Helmet, Maska Level 6 Face Shield, Bastion Helmet, RAC Headphones, Gen 4 Assault Armor, and so on. So as you can see, once again, just like on woods, you can rely on stashes to get yourself geared. If you don't bring in a helmet, chances are you're gonna find a pretty decent or any kind of helmet. If you don't come in with any headphones, you might actually find those. If you don't bring any armor, you can find one in one of those boxes. Actually, speaking of armor, the other day I was playing on Shoreline. I was done with this video already. I wasn't trying to get any more info for this video, so it didn't really go into this table. But the other day I found 3 slicks and 1 hex grid armor in 2 raids on Shoreline. Unfortunately, I didn't find any slicks during the 200 stashes that I did, but you know, like, RNG is quite strong, so you can actually sometimes find some crazy stuff. Now, if we talk about food items, chances of finding a food item are actually really high as well, 31.5%. So once again, it's very likely that you're gonna find food, just like on woods, in one of those stashes. I didn't find any Alyonkas, which would be the second best item to find, but I did find whiskey. So as you can see, we got sugar, we got whiskey, condensed milk, rat cola, vodka. So sugar is still pretty also common to be spawning in one of those stashes as well. And the last category would be other items, which is the biggest category. It has the most amount of items that go into it. We had 211 items that go into others section. And as you can see, it's 105.5% chance of spawning, which is every single raid, basically. Every single raid, every single stash almost, will have one of those other items. The black line that divides items that go over 10k per slot value, it's actually pretty big. Like, the amount of items that you can find that cost more than 10k per slot is pretty big. You actually have to scroll down. So to name a few, the best ones at least, Thermite, Diary, Small Diary, D-Fuel, Nuts, Bolts, Powder, Red Powder, Fuel Conditioner, Syringe, you know, the list goes on. It's actually a much bigger list. So these are all the categories. And if you look at the total numbers, The total value of all items found was over 8 million rubles, which is fairly close to what we had on woods. The total amount of items found is 475. Number of caches looted per raid up to 29. An approximate profit per raid was 800 to 1 million rubles, which is technically the same as woods. As long as you take a big backpack and a big vest, you're gonna be making at least 800k rubles per raid. Sometimes it will be a little bit less, but sometimes it will be way more. So it will even out and it will sit around 800 to 1 million rubles per raid profit. And as you can see, the big portion of the profit came from electronic items, 1.7 million. Then we have 580,000 from treasure items, only 222,000 from medical items, 2 million, almost 2 million and 100k from gear items, half a million from weapons, and 2.4 million from other items. And the surprising thing is we made 700k just from food items, which is surprising because usually, especially late wipe, food doesn't really cost that much. But I guess it's because of the sheer amount of how much food we found. That's why it racked up to 700k. So yeah, so this pretty much summarizes what we found, what we got from those 200 stashes. If you want to look at the table, if you want to look at the spreadsheet yourself and examine it a little bit better, I'll put the link in the video description so you can go there and you can check it out. So to summarize this video, I was curious to do 200 stashes on Shoreline to compare it with woods. And I have to say that the results are actually fairly the same. They're almost the same, really. The only difference was the amount of people and scav encounters I had compared to woods. On woods, I barely had any. On Shoreline, I was having a lot of PMC fights and a lot of scav fights. That also could be because I was doing daytime raids and not nighttime raids. If I was doing nighttime raids, I probably would have had much, much easier time looting all those stashes without being interrupted by anyone. I would say Shoreline is a much faster and much easier map to navigate compared to woods. I was looting all 29 or close to 29 stashes in less time than I was on woods, maybe by 10 minutes. Technically, Shoreline is more time efficient if you want to make money faster. As long as you're doing nighttime, you should be able to make money on Shoreline faster without getting too much risk. But you should keep in mind that Shoreline is a map where a lot of people do quests. So there's a chance you're gonna be still running into people, even at nighttime, especially if it's the first month or first 2 months of the wipe. But all in all, I like this experiment. I really enjoyed running those 200 stashes. It's really a calming way to play the game, in my opinion. And I'm definitely gonna do another video. Next video is gonna be with Interchange, and I'm actually almost done collecting all the data from it. So expect a new video sometime in the future. Thank you for watching, guys. Thank you so much for being here. If you want to check me out when I'm live, you can find the link to my Twitch channel down below in the video description or here on the screen somewhere. If you think this video was informative or if you liked it, please consider hitting a like button or commenting. Commenting actually helps the algorithm to notice your video more, and it's a good way for any YouTube content creator to grow. I'll see you next time.